And that brings us to step two, which is really what you're getting into, the discovery and investigative review. In other words, what kind of things are out there? What kind of things could be out there? What kind of things are out there that I, as the trial lawyer in the case, am not thinking of, either because of my bias, either because I just didn't see it, or some other reason I don't even know about, right? So we can come in and help give an independent, unbiased assessment and then guide the investigative process.
Well, and let's just take the two of us geniuses, because we thought of everything in the 8-shot case, right? I mean, you know, had we known what that woman was going to teach us in that focus group, we could have subpoenaed and requested the complaining witness's credit card records for that night, right? And we would have found, and we did eventually find, much later in the process than, quite frankly, we should have. Shame on us. But that's the point. We're not infallible, and we do get subjected to, you know, I haven't ever done this before, so why am I going to do it now? And so we get the credit card records, and now we see everything that that woman did by that night, including 5 of the 8 rounds of shots. And the beauty of this bar was when we went back and talked to the bar owner, he actually kept good records, and we found out what shots they were.
Sure. We were able to go back, complete the investigation we should have done initially, and get the records we needed to win the case. What we're trying to do here is get involved to head that off at the outset.
And maybe if we weren't trying that case, if we were just consulting on that case and we come in and we look at it as fresh, we see, you know, everyone keeps talking about 8 shots, but nowhere in any of these interviews, nowhere in any of these police reports does anyone say what the shots were, when they were bought, and as it turns out, importantly, who bought them.
And, you know, there's one other part of this stage of it that I think is important to discuss, and that is what I call the "we always do it this way" syndrome.
Right.
You know, and we've all got those in our local jurisdictions. We've all got some thing that's always done that way, and almost to the point where we don't even question it. Maybe it was just ingrained in us as we started practicing law. Maybe it was just one of those things that you just thought, well, that's just how it is. And I can think of a dozen here in Columbus, Ohio, that it's always done this way, so they always continue to do it that way. But it doesn't mean it's right, and it doesn't mean it's best, and it doesn't mean we have to do it that way this time.
Well, and the key is, and I know you and I both believe strongly in the chapter method of cross-examination or direct examination of interviewing and examining witnesses in a trial. The beauty of this kind of investigative process at this early stage is it arms you with the necessary documents and information to truly impeach. So instead of 8 questions about 8 rounds of shots, there's 8 chapters of questions, 10 to 20 questions each, totaling 100 or more questions on those shots, because each round is a different chapter. And the reason it becomes a different chapter is because we now have the documentation that if that witness gets off track, that we can smack her upside the head with the fact that, really, here's your credit card statement. You see how there's $78 in credit card charges at the bar last night? And here are the tabs from the waitress.
And the investigative process lays the groundwork for it. And later on, you're talking about sort of the final trial prep process, and all of them work in conjunction and depend on each other beforehand.
And that's the beauty of getting us involved early, because there's a consistency, there's a plan, and there is an execution of that plan that incorporates all the different moving parts together. So it's not just the investigation, right? We can come in and we can look at the legal side of the defense. We can suggest experts that you may have never thought of. We can suggest motions and legal arguments that we may have never thought of. In fact, the sexual assault case involving the uncle and the niece involved a novel legal argument that you looked at me at first, you're saying, what the hell are you talking about?
Sure. Why? Because we don't do that here.
Right.
It's not done that way. We don't always do it that way here. So it's something new and different. And we tend to not look at things that are novel or different. And I say we because we trial lawyers all do it. The beauty of this is we have to admit it, and then we have to employ the method to expose it and then we can get around that problem.
I'll never forget the first time I suggested to you, hey, Steve, why don't we file a motion challenging this little girl, her ability to testify from personal knowledge, which is a requirement under the rules of evidence in just about any jurisdiction, that they have to testify based on personal knowledge. What if we file a pretrial motion saying she's not testifying from personal knowledge, but rather she's testifying from memories, information, and what have you, implanted in her by the fact that she was questioned by the mother, the father, a police officer, a detective, and then finally a forensic interview. And I said to you, well, let's file a motion challenging that. You looked at me and said, well, we don't do that here. You don't file those kinds of motions. I looked at you and I said, well, why not? And your answer was,
because we don't. Right? I mean, right. It's like, you know, there is no good answer. That's right. The point. And it's not to say that I'm not good at what I do, or you're not good at what you do. It is to say, though, we get stuck in our own ruts, and the method is designed to crowbar us out of that rut and say, all right, there's another way to do it, and let's see where it takes us.